Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
19, 7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I am Chair Amy Gailey, and we have present tonight all of the commissioners, Commissioner Sutton, Commissioner Boswell, Vice Chair Boswell, Commissioner Lashley, and Commissioner Cargill.
Hello, hello.
So, we are here. So, if you care to, please join me in a prayer. Heavenly Father, we lift up our hearts to you this evening with thanksgiving and praise for being allowed to see this day, Lord. We pray that your hand of blessing would be on this county as we do its business tonight, Lord, that we would honor you with our lives, that the things that we do, the words of our lips, and the meditations of our hearts would be pleasing to you, Lord. We pray that you would preserve and protect those who live and sacrifice to the community, who work as teachers or public servants or firefighters, the law enforcement officers, and also, Lord, we remember those who are serving our country overseas and through the armed forces. We just thank you for their servant attitude and that they were willing to be out there to help other people and bless the community, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that we live in the United States, that we have the opportunity to be a self-governing people. We thank you, Lord, for the 200 plus years of governance that this country rests on. And we just pray that you would continue to guide and bless this country and that you would make us worthy of the callings that you have set before us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. First item on our agenda are public speakers, and the first public speaker opportunity is for items that are on the agenda, which we do not have anybody signed up to speak on agenda-related items. So that takes care of that. And I guess we don't have any commissioner responses. So the next thing would be to consider approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Next is the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there is no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right. Next is an update regarding the King Creek Mountain Natural Area with Brian Baker, the head of our Parks Department.
Good evening, Commissioners. I have some map, which I think was requested, as well as just a copy of the slides. I'm going to go through this. So, yeah, I appreciate the opportunity to come talk about the Cane Creek Mountains natural area. I've been up here numerous times about it, but we haven't really had an opportunity to talk globally about it, what it is. So what I'm going to try to do tonight is just provide some information, as well as a little background about history and why we're pursuing this park. So the Cane Creek Mountains Natural Area is a result of our recreational master plan that we did in 2007. So a long time ago, that plan recommended that we develop a 1,000-acre around size facility. Thank you, Scott. as a district park, working with the state to acquire some property for a district park. So we started working on this really 2008, 2009, right after that master plan recommended that. It was repeated in the 2017 master plan, which is our most recent. Of course, we had done some work by then, and it specified that that new district park would be the Cane Creek Mountains natural area. But I want to spend just a minute on where that recommendation came from and why those master plans recommended we do this. And there's three main reasons. The first is that this is what people ask for most often. So every master plan we do, pretty much every master plan that's done, been done across the state in the past 20 years has had the same result. The number one thing people request is places to walk and places to hike. We do a lot of public outreach for these master plans, with surveys and focus groups and public meetings, and universally this is what they want. A lot of different variations on it, but they want a place to walk, a place to hike. So that's number one. And the second is there's a need in this county, just by chance, because of a hole that's left by some of the other local governments or other state and federal governments. So in 87 of the 100 counties in North Carolina, there are some sort of natural areas preserved by the state or federal government. So state parks, hunting grounds, or national forests are the most common. So 87 counties out of 100 have that, and we don't. So we're one of the 13 that doesn't have a district park-sized facility from the state or federal government, so there's a little bit of a gap there left to fill by the local government. And the final reason for the proposal was that, as you guys know well, we're experiencing growth, have been experiencing growth. They saw a need for a district park in the future, and if you're going to do that, the sooner the better. Land prices go up and availability goes down. So the recommendation was to acquire the land as soon as possible. So just to illustrate that last point about our growth, a couple quick slides. This is what we looked like in 1960. So the green is forest and farmland. The gray is urban, and the yellow is our suburban area. If we fast forward 50 years to 2010, there's a big change in the amount of land that's taken up by urban and suburban needs. And this is even 10 years ago from now. And then the forecast to 2030, what we're going to look like. It's a lot of growth and a lot of competing uses that make it very difficult to acquire parkland. We're still okay. There's still some areas in green in our county, but if you look at our neighbors, Guilford, Orange, and Durham, who are probably 10, 20 years ahead of us on the growth curve, they don't have many choices. It would be very difficult for those counties to acquire a significant piece of property to do parks with. So that was our motivation to get this going. And once we decided to do it, it's a matter of figuring out where we can put it. Our first consideration for that was, if you're going to build a park, it's got to be a special place. It's got to be a place people want to visit. And so we looked at our natural heritage areas. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, a natural heritage area is a program the state does, the state natural heritage office goes out and surveys all 100 counties, and they pinpoint and map the most special biological places that we have, what ecosystems are out there, what plants and animals make certain parts of the counties unique and are worth preserving. As you can see from that map, we don't have that many. There's just not that many places in our county that the state has mapped out for us as places that need to be saved. Stony Creek West Reservoir in the north is one. Cedar Rock Park, the Hull River, where we're already doing some work, and King Creek Mountain is by far large.
How many acres is Cedar Rock?
About 500 now.
Mm-hmm. And I bet the section we just bought.
That's 75, so it was 425. So
is that part of the 500?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, it started as 425. So looking at this map, there's a couple other areas we could have pinpointed, but it was pretty obvious for us we needed to start exploring the Cane Creek Mountains and see if it was suitable. And really, the more we looked at it, the more obvious it became this is a great place for us to do a public park. I'm not going to go deep into science because I can't, but I'll just tell you, the Cane Creek Mountains is a remnant. It's a Piedmont Monadnock, which is basically the same thing as Pilot Mountain, same thing as Ogeechee Mountain. It's left over from what was once the tallest mountain range in the world, as tall as anything we have now. It was created when Africa and North America slammed into each other. So that was 500 million years ago. It's had a little time to erode. And all of the eastern part of North Carolina, the Piedmont, the coastal plain, the sand hills are a result of that erosion. So that's just land from these mountains that flattened out. And this is all that's left. So that genesis makes it very unique. And there's things there that you can't find just on a regular hill because of where it came from. And so it's a special place. It's now left over. It's the highest peak east of Greensboro. 987 is a lot different than 15,000 feet, but it once was, but still the highest point east of Greensboro. And when you get up there, there's a really fantastic view. You can see Greensboro, you can see Durham in the winter. So it's a cool place to be.
Is that where you're going to put the tower?
Yeah.
Are you not going to use the one that's up there on the...
We don't own that one, no, and it's in disrepair.
In bad shape.
Yeah, so our hope would be to put a new one. Yeah, it would be roughly that spot, just to get above the tree line.
How far apart is tower then now and the new tower?
Pretty good distance.
Have you even thought about it that far yet?
I would think, we know where we want to put it. It's probably a mile as the crow flies, the distance-wise. It's a pretty good part of it.
Have you had any engineering...
No, we've had some guys who know what they're doing come out and talk to us about it.
Okay.
And tell us what it would take and what kind of budget it would be. And that's kind of as far as we've gotten because we don't have the money to do more. So okay. We'll come back to you when things change. So, it's also the largest area of undisturbed woodland in Alamance County. So it's the largest piece of property that hasn't been farmed or disturbed, and it's remarkably undisturbed up there. It's not, the land itself is really not suitable.
It's never been timbered any.
There's been some timbering on the bottom portions. I think there's some evidence on closer to the top, maybe some selective timber a long time ago, but you really can't tell. And you couldn't grow anything there. It's about 2 inches of topsoil, and then you hit rock that's attached to the earth. There's very few houses, cabins, or uses that have ever been used there. Something that's important to realize when we looked into it was it's right next to the Three College Observatory. If you're not familiar with that, it's one of the largest observatories on the East Coast, operated by three different universities here. They were very concerned about maintaining their dark skies, making sure they would still have the ability to see things from the telescope as growth encroached on them. So they were very happy to have us consider this property. That's actually a picture of a lunar eclipse taken from the observatory.
Now, where's the observatory?
It's off Thompson Mill Road. When we get to a map, I can get a little. There's not a lot of directions out there, but
yeah, that's for sure.
You access it off Thompson Mill Road. It's also right next to YMCA Camp Frontier, which is a great opportunity. We have already had discussions with them about ways that we could cooperate. They are very excited about using the park for their camp, but they really only use the camp about 8 weeks a year. So we're excited about cooperating with them on the other months when they're not using it. And it feels like a good partnership there. There's also 4 miles of stream on the property. So you get a lot of bang for your buck as far as water quality and protecting the riparian buffers on this property. It contains little ecosystems there that we just don't have anywhere else. Something that was exciting to me, the last thing, this property hosted Camp Pioneer, which is Pioneer Camp. It's kind of an obscure nature camp that I didn't even know about, but it started in 1937 by former school teachers, and they ran it for 15, 20 years in the 40s up until the 50s. It was a nature camp for kids come out there, learn survival skills, nature skills, and it was not neat to know we're not the only people who thought this property was perfect for a park. And so that fireplace is left over from the lodge that was built on the site. And thank you to the Times News for letting me steal your newspaper picture. So all of that really convinced us that this is a great place for us to do the district park our master plan called for, and we started working on acquiring, talking to the landowners, seeing what the possibilities were. It took us a while to get our first piece, but we acquired the Faircloth Tract in 2014, which is 101 acres. In 2018, we acquired the Presnell Tract. Just this year, very recently, we acquired the Henderson-Dixon Tract, and the last piece of the puzzle for us would be the Sizemore Tract, which we're hoping to acquire in 2020. Went to Raleigh last week for the grant meeting where they give away the money, and we were very lucky to be funded in a competitive year. So we were funded for this project. So we're fully funded to close out the project with this final piece. Like I said, I've obviously been up here a lot asking, you know, for this grant or that, but we haven't had an opportunity to discuss this as a whole, but I just listed the times that this has come up on the agenda for you guys to be approved.
Have you gotten an estimate on what it would cost to put the trails, the hiking trails in? Are there hiking trails already out there? And
There's four-wheeler trails out there. Some four-wheeler trails out there, some of which can be repurposed, most of which cannot. So we're planning on doing most of the trail building ourselves. Our guys are trained on that. We're pretty skilled at it. It's a lot of work, so it's kind of slow if you do it ourselves. We've also had a couple different volunteer groups ask to come be a part of that. Paying for trail building is very expensive, so that's not part of our plan right now.
What bothers me about this whole situation is what you're doing tonight, you should have done 4 or 5 years ago and let the commissioners be aware that you're buying this property. I was on the commissioners for 24 years, and I wasn't aware until a couple of months ago that this was the master plan. Mm-hmm. And I've been voting for land to be asking for funds, but I didn't know why. And finally, I had enough information to ask the question. Everybody should have been, all these commissioners should have been told years ago.
Well, and if you would, if I can, commissioners, I would like to say that, you know, this, I remember this project started under my direction as head of the Parks Department originally, and I remember bringing it to the board and talking about all the things Brian's talking about, how nice the property is. And I think we have felt like all along we've been successful in this project. We've been able to acquire these tracks at no cost to the county. Brian has done and planned the development in a way that won't burden his department. So if there's been a lack of transparency or the commissioners have felt like that they have not understood the project and what's going on, that is on me. I started this project originally. It's my responsibility to make sure that you're all informed about what we're up to. So I think what Brian's doing tonight, and I've asked him to come and make sure this is clear, because again, it is a pretty unique place in Alamance County. So
I think I'm in favor of the park. But I think 620 acres, along with Cedar Rock Park, Shallow Ford, mm-hmm. How many acres in there?
Just under 200.
Yeah. And we got parks all over the county. You know, I don't know how big you want the recreation and parks to be. You want them to own the entire county?
Well,
that's what it sounds like to me.
I want to get out ahead of our growth. I think this is probably the last.
Me and Peggy and I walk every Sunday somewhere, and we know all these. We walk all these parks.
Yeah.
We don't need any more parks.
Yeah.
In my opinion, I think what you got 620 acres is a God's planning, along with Shallow Ford, Cedar Rock Park, Red Slide, and the what's the other one? Patty
Glencoe. Yeah.
And that's, mm-hmm. Well, we got parks everywhere.
Yeah.
I think we got too many parks. I think 620 acres where we at today is fine, but we don't need to add 400 more. That's just my thinking.
Well, have we looked at the revenue, what potential revenue these parks might produce for the county?
We do. So let me
skip. Parks don't make revenue. The people that come to the parks,
right,
buy gas,
eating out.
You can't go by that.
So that's just a little bit on the economic impact. And you know, this is kind of a one-time economic impact. But I do want to point out that we've had a lot of partners on this because we haven't come to the county and asked for money for acquisition or for development. That's pretty unusual in the local government world. That's not the way things are done. They're mostly general fund requests. We haven't done that, and we've raised a lot of money from these grant sources and from our partners, Piedmont Land Conservancy and the Conservation Fund in particular. So $4.6 million is what we've raised, and that's all been paid to Alamance County citizens who own that property and is getting recycled in the community, but it is a one-time payment. As for the tax revenue, I certainly understand that concern. So we just looked at the past, roughly 5 years of tax data from when these properties were in private ownership and took an average for those past 5 years. So all told, with these four tracks, we're losing about $13,500 a year in revenue.
Looks like they were in present use value.
Yeah. And so that's not an insignificant amount. I don't want to diminish that. That's real money. But I do feel like that the amount that we can generate through sales tax is going to offset that. So a pretty conservative estimate for me of how many people we're going to get to this park is between 100,000 and 200,000. I feel pretty sure that within the first couple of years, we'll be at 200,000.
Yeah, I think 620 acres can handle every one of them. We don't need 1,000.
Yeah. So there's only two ways to get to this park. You're either coming on 49 or you're coming on 87. And if you have a place that sells gas or food or water on those, I think you're going to see an impact from an extra 200,000 people.
Which map has got the additional new section?
Let me go back to that slide for you.
I think it's a front one.
So it's this one.
The very first one.
Yes, the first one. Yeah. So
it's in the handout slides. Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure what number it is.
Parson Land.
After that. After where you were, Commissioner Sutton.
Those reports,
yeah.
I shuffle these. Like,
towards the back.
Right. What's the difference between the final? Thank you. And which part is the new part? Right.
The red.
The red
part outlined in red is the last track we're
going to acquire. Okay. What's the difference in the final status? Of what this would be versus Hall River State Park. The fact that it's a state park, or is it going to be?
This isn't going to be a state
park. I don't think so.
Yeah. No, so as far as the legal status, this is a county park. We've worked with the state on this, so half of this money is coming from the state. They're going to protect it in the same way that they protect state parks in exchange for that. But we are going to operate. So honestly, the way we have designed these parks, and we do it intentionally, just like we have Shallow Ford Natural Area, it doesn't take off. I don't anticipate having full-time employees, even one full-time employee, tasked to this all day, every day. It's a parking area and it's trails. So
Shallow Ford is a wonderful park. It's really, if you've never been out there, you need to go. It's a high mountain out there too. Thinking of when we go to the National Forest, out west, we go out there and get ready to go. Those are mountains out there.
Yeah. Yeah, those are real mountains.
Well, this is a real mountain here, Bill. You have more to climb.
Yeah, I think we don't need 400 more acres.
So from a maintenance standpoint, it's the same design. We'll have a parking area, and we send a guy there once or twice a day.
Just adding the land. And
it doesn't. The initial push to build all the trail is hard.
Yeah, I know.
And after that, the maintenance is, if you do it right, you build them right, the maintenance is pretty limited. So
y'all do a good job maintaining the
Our guys are trained up. Paths. They do it right.
Yeah,
they do it.
The parking lots.
Where are we in the acquisition process right now?
So we just got funded last week, and so we're waiting on that contract to get signed from the state to give us the money, and then we're ready to close.
They've got 620 acres that they own now, and they want 400 more. Right. That's what I'm going to make a motion.
Already for the 400 additional acres.
I'm going to make a motion that we stop buying land at 620 acres. I think that's enough for the county that we don't need 1,000 acres.
So I will say, to the extent we're talking about, you're interested in the significant natural heritage area park, right? So there's a public park aspect of this, and there's just a conserving a special place in Alamance County Park. We could certainly run a park with 600 acres. That'd be great.
That is a wonderful place. I used to be in the boat club down there at the Boys Camp.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that is beautiful area.
It's beautiful. A significant part of this natural heritage area is on this piece of property we haven't acquired yet. That would be my only hesitation. So the Presnell tract, which is the top green tract we've acquired already, the southern portion of that is really pretty special land. The top part, quite honestly, is not. It was timberland. It's been timbered, and we're kind of letting that reforest, but it's not very attractive land right now. But a lot of the special places are on the creeks that you see on that red parcel. And there's some unique spots there that we would be missing by not acquiring this final piece.
And back in February, we're the ones that voted to approve to let you move forward with the grant.
I do come ask permission in advance. Okay. Before
that was when? February this year.
You've referred four or five times to district park.
It's not a particularly meaningful distinction. It's just recreation and parks talk. It means something, 800 to 1,200 acres.
It has some inference or possibly the people from other counties will come here.
Right, yeah. A regional park would be bigger than that to bring people from a region like the zoo. A district park is you're pulling people from a couple counties over.
Will you have any bicycle trails at all on them?
Not at this park, and that's the prerogative of the state. So the way that they're funding this, they don't allow bicycle trails. They're harder on
that. Greensboro does in some of their parks.
Yeah, and there's demand for that, and I'd love to do it. It's just when it's not your money, you don't get all the rules. So yeah.
What about camping?
We'll be allowed to put camping on this. So the extent of the development here is really primarily hiking trails. There's going to be 10 to 12 miles of trail there. Some primitive camping sites, so tent camping, and then the observation tower, if we can work that out. I think that is really going to be the highlight of the property. We have a lot of places that are backcountry for hikers. You know, if you want to get 2 miles away from the parking area, we've got places to do that. We don't have a ton of places where, if that's not something you can do, where you can come and experience the natural part of Alamance County. And this is a good opportunity for that. I think we're gonna be able to place this at the highest point, next to the highest point in the county on the mountain range, and get it within 2/3 of a mile of the parking area. So it'll be very popular, I think, with kids, with older people, or just folks who can't walk several miles to get way back in there. That's the part I'm excited about. When you get, you would have no idea this place is there. And it, quite honestly, driving by, it doesn't seem that remarkable. But when you get on those points where we took this picture, it is remarkable. And I'm excited about getting people there, getting them to see that view. It's just a different perspective.
Point out the roads, if you will. I can't see them.
The roads?
Yeah, the roads that go through that area.
Yeah, sure. So, I don't know if it's a little pointy. No, not really. So the far left side is Mount Hermon Rock Creek Road, and that runs up on top. To the top of the map would go to the sawmill. Okay. The black road right through the middle of the property, right next to YMCA Camp Frontier, that's Bass Mountain Road.
Okay.
And on the far right, kind of out of the map, but down there where Three College Observatory is, that's Thompson Mill Road. So if this is, maybe as the crow flies, a mile and a half, 2 miles south of the sawmill.
Show me where the TV station was, the religious, years ago.
Remember that? Right here, the Three College thing.
Is it on that map?
I'm not sure.
I think it's right in that area, though.
So where the radio station was, or where the fire tower is?
TV station, religious TV station.
Yeah.
I think that's over by the fire tower, which is on the southern end of that red tract, where that kind of funny shaped area is. Yeah. So that's...
That's the road nobody can get up.
That's the road nobody can get up. Yeah. That's fire tower road.
Was that in trouble?
We are not planning to use that as a park.
Yeah, but it's better.
It's better than it used to be. You can at least drive up there now. I can't remember when you couldn't do that.
That would be a great access because it takes you right to the top, but
yeah.
It's not a maintenance problem we're interested in.
The state, if I'm not mistaken, over the Hall River, now they've got Northeast Park in Guilford County, I think is real nice. But they've got another one that's just, in my opinion, a complete disaster. I'm not sure. I mean, I've been there. It's just never anybody there. And they've done all they're going to do to it. But Northeast is nice,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
I don't know how many acres that is versus this. But Hall River, they built a lodge. They have meeting rooms and they have a lot. Remember, Brian, I sent you pictures of it, and a swimming pool, and people come from all over the state to, well, at least this region, to have conferences there.
They come from all over.
Yeah, Duke Medical Center, Duke University, and other close by areas.
They inherited that.
Yeah.
They wouldn't have built it, but it used to be a summer camp.
That's right. So the state did build it, right?
Yeah, but
that was a church.
It was a church camp.
Yeah, okay.
So
you're right.
But they operate and they do a great job. In my world, we have a lot of meetings up there, so it's constantly being used, and they rent rooms. It's a great facility. I don't have any plans for that here, but certainly it's an opportunity.
Before you go, will you explain to Thomas Morawski what the continental drift theory is?
Not today. I think Thomas knows.
I know what it is.
That's all I have.
Well, be sure.
No action. I don't have any action on this, but whatever. If I can answer any more questions, I'll be happy.
Well, we do have a motion on the table, I guess. Mr. Lashley, I just ask, you know, they've had $2 million of outside funds approved to buy the 438 acres. I guess that would mean that money would be returned back to the state.
Well, I'm okay with it returning. I don't think we even got the money yet. So the property has already been bought by the conservation fund. So the original owner wanted out. We're so far into this process and on our fourth parcel that the conservation fund bought the property.
Have you signed any papers?
We are not obligated to buy that property. There would be some frustration and disappointment if we decided not to go through at this point because they're stuck holding a piece of property.
But I was elected to do the things for Alamance County voters and taxpayers. I don't care what if somebody's in another county get their feelings hurt. I could care less. I was elected to represent Alamance County, not any place else.
Am I correct? If it's in the conservation fund, then it's off the tax map.
It's already off the tax maps. Yes.
So
we're not going to lose anything else by acquiring
it. Right. It's not our money.
Mm-hmm. Right. Don't want to vote on anything anyhow. It's already been voted on.
Yeah.
Well, it appears that Mr. Lashley's motion is died for lack of a second, unless there anybody has anything else to say about it. I would be willing to make a motion that we say as a board that this is the end of this project and that the board won't consider adding more to it. That the acquisition of the Sizemore tract ends the development of the Cane Creek Mountain Natural Area.
This is our last planned acquisition, so I'm comfortable with this.
I'll make that motion.
It's down the hill, don't you?
Because I think Mr. Lashley's concerns definitely have validity. It seems that sort of the train left the station with the Sizemore tract and other things, but yeah, I make that motion that we commit as a board not to approve any more acquisitions to the Cane Creek Mountains natural area beyond what has already been approved. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any more discussion about that? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All right. Thank you very much. That was a very good presentation.
Thanks, Brian. Right.
Okay, moving forward, we've got a bunch of financial stuff to work on. Mr. Haygood, do you have a presentation in advance of us having a public hearing on financing some equipment?
I do. Good evening, Commissioners. We've got several items on our agenda for tonight's meeting that have to do with getting our capital plan rolling. Now, I thought it might be helpful to start off with just a quick presentation that will give you some idea of these projects that we're talking about tonight. So I have a handout for each of you.
Thank you.
Just one, there we go.
So we're going to be talking about tonight and taking some action and recommending action for a couple of things that are involved in our capital plan. And I thought it'd be helpful just to remind you, when we adopted the budget this year, we also adopted the county's capital plan. And just a little reminder about the capital plan. We haven't had one in a long time. It's very new to us. But the reason you do a capital plan, if you recall, is to separate from operations our capital. So we made a real conscious effort of focusing on capital and setting money aside for it. So these things that we're going to talk about tonight, the two loans that we're talking about, we have money available to do these two loans. We've put all of our projects for county government, school system, ACC, and the courts into our capital plan, and we've used it as a way to establish timelines and to project when we need to finance debt. And we also hope that it'll demonstrate to you and to the public and to all the people that count on us for facilities that we have a plan, we know what we're doing, and we're keeping up with it. So I think it's important for us to take time to distinguish. So the scene of this public hearing that's about to happen has to do with a $1.5 million installment loan plan. And basically, if you remember, when we did our budget this fiscal year, we incorporated two pieces for county government's capital needs. One was the ability to purchase outright different items, different pieces of equipment. The total for the purchase that's in this year's budget is $930,963. So there's a list of things that we plan to purchase. They will not be financed. They will be bought with money that has been budgeted. And then we also had a piece of this year's budget that was debt service for 4 years, $402,343. That will allow us to finance a little over $1.5 million. This is what the public hearing will be about in just a moment. And we plan to use that $1.5 million to buy communications equipment. You remember we need to install a new VHF transponder up in the northern part of the county so EMS and fire department pagers will work properly, and also put some new equipment, some backup equipment in our CCOM department. We also have five emergency service vehicles in this financing that you'll hear about, and the main one of those is a new air truck. I think that air truck's around $375,000. That's a big purchase. We also have eight general government vehicles. These are elsewhere. This list is elsewhere in your packet, but and we have one mower that is included in the finance plan. So in a moment, we'll do a public hearing that has to do with this $1.5 million loan. Then we have another loan that we're going to start the process tonight. This is a $5 million loan for county government. This is in our capital plan. That means the capacity to pay the debt service is already in place. You don't need to do anything to create the funds to pay the debt service. It's already there. These are the projects that we'll be getting the process started for this evening. We have some HVAC work that we need to do at Civil Court right next door. We have work to do on the EMS roof, Family Justice Center roof, and the historic courthouse roof. The biggest project in this $5 million loan list is to go to the Human Service Center, the Old County Hospital, and do a tremendous amount of HVAC work. That building needs some significant HVAC work. We're also going to work on all the elevators in that building. If you remember, we had issues over the past couple of years with elevators failing. People are having difficulty getting up and down the floors. And to do some paving. If you remember, we tore down the old training center that was there on Graham Hopedale Road. It was in front of the county hospital. It was in terrible shape. And we need some paved parking over there. So we're gonna add a little bit of parking where that building was. We've also got $1.3 million in the $5 million loan list to do HVAC work over at the jail, also to do some foundation repair work over at the jail, and to do a significant renovation to the area that is currently the exercise area. And we've been talking with the sheriff about turning that into dorm-style housing that allows us to hold more inmates in a dorm manner that takes less supervision. So. And we have a little over $500,000 budgeted out of the $5 million for the J.B. Allen Criminal Courts HVAC work and roof replacement that needs to be done. And we're also factoring in 1% for borrowing costs. That's for our bond attorney and our financial folks. So $5 million loan, it's a part of the capital plan. The funding is there to do this, and you'll hear a little bit more about what the next steps are. We also have funding in our 1920 budget. If you remember, every year we budget $250,000 a year to take care of some smaller items. We have a couple of generator projects. We're going to add generator hookups at the Board of Elections, as well as at the county annex across the street. We also need to replace the septic and drain field down at Eli Whitney Gym down Greensboro Chapel Hill Road. County office building elevator is the most expensive item in this list, but it is in significant need of renovation and replacement. And we're also doing some work at EMS, do some office renovations and add a generator to the EMS base. The total is $261,280 for our CIP work. That is including $11,000+ from last fiscal year that's carried over. That's why it's not 2 feet. And finally, for this fiscal year, this is a busy year. It's a busy capital time. We have a few projects that I call special projects. These are ones that are not necessarily, they're in our capital plan, but I thought they were worth mentioning because they will all come to completion this year too. One of them is the Petrie building. You remember Mr. Petrie that donated $3.2 million to build the new building behind HSC. That is underway now. Construction has not started. Ground hasn't been broken, but the design work, surveying, those things are being done. So that'll be completed this fiscal year. Animal shelter, if you'll recall, the board designated $2.9 million for the animal shelter. That's the county share for the new construction. We feel very certain that the animal shelter will be finished this year, and they'll call for our contribution. And the final piece, as you all, I'm sure, are aware, is the state just recently gave Gabby Holland and her folks the approval to move forward with purchasing new boating equipment. So we had in our capital plan funded to do the debt service up to $3 million to borrow so we can get that equipment. So we are working feverishly with Kathy. I thought I saw her earlier, but we're working very, very hard with her to get that equipment purchased so she can do testing, so she can be ready for the upcoming elections. This is just to try to give you an idea, because there's a lot of items on the agenda that have to do with these capital processes. So I thought it was worthwhile to go over this with you, put it in front of you, and as we go through this information, it'll help you keep up with all of these projects. The public hearing that you're getting ready to enter into, it has to do with the $1.5 million loans. That's for the CECOM VHF transponders, the fire truck, the things like that. The commissioner set this public hearing date as part of this loan process back on August 16th. And this public hearing that you will do now, and the resolution that is the next item on the agenda, it pretty much ends the $1.5 million loan process. After that, we're pretty much ready to go. And what we've told departments is the funding from this loan should be available to them, if the board goes through with these actions tonight, by October 1st. So at that point, I'm certainly here if anyone has any questions, but yes, sir.
I had to raise my hand.
Yes.
Brian, to give you a break.
Brian.
He's on the move.
Gives him a chance to take a breath.
Do that ever-rating battery commercial.
Yes.
Seriously, go back to the sheriff on the jail, the conversion of the outdoor recreation. Is that the corner spot?
Yes, it's the gymnasium.
No, it's not the outdoor?
Inside. No, sir.
Okay. Because you know, INS requires the outdoor recreation.
Not anymore.
So, but I mean, is that what we're doing away with, or are we keeping that?
No, they've never been, when we initially met several years ago, they did away with the outdoor recreation. They're able to come out into their pods, watch TV, exercise, play cards, whatever they want to do. The gymnasium we had there never been used. It was used very few times by employees, but other than that. So with the growth in population, we had a guy come and look and think they can get 24 more beds in there with three showers, bathrooms.
Now, is that the corner area where it had the open space at the top?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So that was considered outdoor recreation.
Right, and that's INS. Been closed in since. It's not.
Okay, so INS or ICE would never require that again?
No.
Based on our contracts?
That's correct.
Well, that space that recreation was for employees, right?
Yes, sir. But very seldom used.
Right.
But we put it in there to tune of $800,000.
Yep.
When we did the new jail to meet INS standards, so yeah, that we could sign a contract with them. That's how it got there. I think it was way back. Mm-hmm.
All right. Do you think that you could put the slide that's related to the $1.5 million, maybe put that up, and then as we go through the following presentations, votes, we'll kind of scroll through that. All right, so with the presentation about the financing of $1.5 million for equipment and vehicle purchase projects being completed, may I have a motion to open the public hearing?
May I ask one more question?
Of course.
I apologize. And in regards to the, man, these things are alive tonight. In relation to the roof repairs, do we feel like we're getting it done per square foot cheaper than what the school pays for theirs, or is it a different type of job, or what is it?
I think these are multiple different types of work. I was looking to see.
Richard's probably in the
buddies.
Well,
that now.
I don't know what
school's
paying to get theirs done, but we just got estimates from our engineer that we use to design the repair work, and when we put a new roof on, he does the scope of work. Also, he also writes what the warranty is for the new roof, and he gives me an estimated square foot of what it's cost now to do that type of roof.
See, the schools don't like to do the membranes, they don't like to do this type of repair.
Well, he does cool samples every time to see if there's anything needs size, just a service that needs replacing.
Right.
When you do the roof repair, if it needs to be a total tear off.
Is that a single ply roof? Is that a single ply?
Most of them have insulation board down, and then
And a single ply on top.
Yeah.
Is that what that is?
Well, some of them single ply, some of them two plies. You got a cap sheet that goes over top of the first layer.
As long as you got it anchored down good, it won't blow off.
Yeah. But we hadn't put anything out to bid yet, and I got the contracts for the engineer whenever we get the money approved for him to do the side work, so we can bid it out and get like multiple bids on it, so we can get the lowest possible bid that does good work. Because some of these companies you had to watch to underbid and don't cover everything that's in the scope of work.
That's for sure.
Do we have a motion to open the public?
I'll make the motion, yes.
And you should say
second. Go on the public.
Okay. So we've opened a public hearing regarding the $1.5 million for equipment and vehicle purchase projects. Is there anybody on to your right, my left, side of the room who wishes to be heard about that contract? Seeing no one indicating they want to be heard, to my right, your left, is there anybody on this side of the room who wants to be heard about the vehicle purchase or the equipment and vehicle purchase projects and the financing? Okay, and the fire marshal's indicated there's nobody in the overflow room who wants to be heard. So may I have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Set.
We have a motion and a second to close the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? I think I forgot to call for a vote.
Yeah,
on
the original. That's
it. So, should we do it all over again?
A vote on what?
On the motion to open the
public hearing. We never had a vote on it.
I think we're all okay with it. Sorry. All right, so next is a resolution to deal with the installment loan.
That's correct. We have a resolution in your packet that pertains to this $1.5 million loan. This is the final step in the issuance process. The resolution before you does the following things. It includes required findings. Basically, what it says is that this loan is the proper way to purchase this equipment, and the items that we're buying are justifiable and reasonable. The resolution also authorizes a finance agreement with J.P. Morgan Chase Bank of North America. The resolution authorizes the county manager to execute the agreement with J.P. Morgan, and it also authorizes staff to execute any necessary documents that are involved with this loan. The county staff issued an RFP for this $1.5 million loan. The board authorized that RFP August 19th of 2019. And the bids on that loan services were received and were opened on August 30th. We had six respondent banks. The bid tabulations are in your packet. Staff is recommending J.P. Morgan Chase Bank of North America. The contract and the agreement with J.P. Morgan is in your packet also. So at this point, if the board does vote to approve the resolution that's before you, then we will proceed with borrowing these funds.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve that resolution. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
What's the future now? What's going to pop up next year?
My plan is the $930,000 of purchase power will every year will be for purchasing capital. So that's how we'll buy sheriff vehicles, ambulance, stretchers. We're going to dedicate that $930,000 every year to purchase. It'll take 4 years to pay this debt. When this debt is paid in 4 years, we'll look at what would that amount of debt service buy us. Again, and I'll be coming back before the board hopefully to say we have other vehicles, capital equipment, those kind of needs, and we'll be asking you to consider rolling that loan over and buying more stuff. But you know, it's a combination of purchase and finance, and we are making payments, but we're stretching our buying power out, and hopefully it's going to keep emergency services in the vehicles regularly that they need. And also many of the county departments in vehicles and equipment too. So.
Okay, Mr. Hager, would you mind please, now we're moving on to the $5 million loan financing, would you please scroll the presentation to that slide so that we can have that up?
Yes.
And so I guess Andrea is going to tell us about this.
Good evening, commissioners. Susan Evans was not able to be here, so I will try to present and answer any questions. For your consideration are two resolutions related to this $5 million loan. Separate approval is requested for each of the resolutions. The first resolution is authorizes staff to take all the necessary first steps to borrow the $5 million. So it includes the findings, the required findings, information. It authorizes staff to issue a bank RFP. It also allows us to obtain legal and financial services as needed. And since this loan will be a 15-year loan, it will require LGC approval. And that resolution will authorize staff to set that up, to request LGC approval at the appropriate time. The second resolution would set a public hearing. We would put out the RFP, bring that back at the same time as the public hearing, just as we did the $1.5 million loan today, and we would like to set that for December 2nd. That puts it within about a 30-day timeline of the first LGC meeting in January. So that would allow us to get an RFP for bank services with interest rates that they would hold firm in time for us to go to the LGC. This resolution, both of them were prepared by our bond attorney to request a vote. The board chair or a board member should read the title of the resolution in their motion to request the vote. And again, separate votes are needed for each resolution.
Okay, I'll go ahead and make that motion that we approve a resolution making certain findings and appointments and requesting approval of the local government commission. Did I say that right?
Thank you. Yes.
Second that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And then I will make the second motion to approve a resolution calling for a public hearing on whether the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina, should approve a proposed installment financing to finance a portion of the cost of various projects.
Second to that.
We have a motion and a second to approve that resolution. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you. And next, the capital project ordinance. Is that the capital improvement or the CIP? Is that this slide? Is that relevant to this?
It's still part of the $5 million loan project. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
So this action, for your consideration, is a capital project ordinance that will budget the loan proceeds, the $5 million loan proceeds. It allows staff to get started on some of the renovation projects that have already been priced. So for Buddy to go out and get engineering costs to assess the roofs, he needs to be able to spend some money in this capital project resolution. Would allow us to budget the entire amount of the $5 million. He would spend some piece of it, and we would be able to reimburse ourselves from the loan proceeds.
So where are we borrowing that money from? Fund balance, I guess?
We would be getting a bank loan. We would be getting
We would front it from fund balance until the loan came through.
That was my question.
Yes, sir.
That just got allocated out of. Okay.
That's through Chase.
This one we would have to put out for RFP.
Okay.
We would find out by December 2nd. We would bring a recommendation.
And we're using this capital project ordinance model because these projects will probably go beyond one fiscal year. There's going to be ordering of parts and engineering that needs to be done, so it's quite possible this will stretch beyond a fiscal year. So it keeps these funds separate from the general fund, and once they're in this capital project ordinance, the project can just go until it is done.
Okay, Mr. Carter's made a motion to approve the capital project ordinance.
Second.
A second from Mr. Lashley. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
I cut my mic off. How come there's so much reverberation in here?
I think we down there. I can answer that global warming.
We had some complaints about being able to pick up more people, so we cranked it up just a little bit, so we're playing around with that a little bit. So
I cut mine off and it's still going.
I thought it was my new hearing aids, is what I thought.
It's amazing the number of folks that watch these videos. When we had that one video that we had the issue with the sound, a lot of people watch these, so I think we've tried very hard to make sure it's audio's good and folks can hear, but it's a very popular show to watch.
So.
I can't imagine.
Our ratings may not be
That's
good.
Right. The Ben's watching.
Is it under comedy on the...
I think so. It should be.
So I have an item before you at this time, Commissioners, where we're requesting to designate funds from fiscal year 18-19 for the following uses. These are funds that we're going to take from last fiscal year, designate for these specific uses, and make them available if they are needed. We're asking the Commissioners to, and this is typical end of the year designations that we do, but these are ones that I wanted to explain and be sure we're clear. So if you remember, when we were doing the budget for 1920, the Board of Elections asked for some significant amount of money. They're in a little bit of an uproar, not sure how many districts they're going to have. They had a lot of unknowns. Rather than budget a tremendous amount of new money in their budget, we said we would designate some funding for them in the event they need it. That dollar amount is $207,297. We also discussed the possible need to budget money for lawsuit settlements. And instead of putting it in 1920's budget, I'm requesting that we designate that from funds from 1819 in the amount of $200,000. We're also asking to designate $225,000 for economic development awarded grants. We have some companies that we think are eligible to receive their grants, but they have not contacted us or asked. And we budget for folks that have contacted us. So to be on the safe side, we feel like we should designate some funding in the event these companies do come to us and ask for their grant. And if it's been earned, we want to make sure we have the funding available to pay them. And we also have $39,012 that is to carry through the sheriff's office with vehicle packages. They were working on this last fiscal year, did not complete it. So we're asking to designate $39,012 so they can finish up with their vehicle packages. The total dollar amount we're asking the board to designate from fiscal year 18-19 is $671,309. So it does take a vote to do this. $671,309.
Sheriff, how much have we gotten so far from ICE and from Marshals? And you got a number on that?
Yeah, $2,994,098.38 has been received since February.
And how much have we spent?
I was checking with Susan to find out, but probably a third of that.
We appreciate the way the sheriff and his staff have worked very closely with us to make sure we're all on the same page about the revenue that's come in, the expenditures that have come out. I think sheriff's folks spend a lot of time with finance, making sure it's very clear what we're spending ICE money on and the U.S. Marshal money on. And it's been, it sounds like it's been a very successful program thus far. Yes, sir.
Okay. We'd be seeking a motion to approve those designations.
So move.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to do that. So is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and then approval to apply for a health department grant.
There's sparks flying.
So good evening. So tonight I'm asking for approval to apply for an FDA grant. We've received this grant in the past. So prior to submitting our grant, I'm seeking approval to apply and budget an award up to $9,000. Typically, we apply for this grant for, I think in your packet, there are certain categories, and we apply for it for small projects and training. And this is, while our state sort of adopts the FDA food code, this program and this grant allows us to also implement some of those uniform standards for inspections and food safety. And so the training funds would go toward meeting and setting those retail food program codes or standards and goals. And some of the small projects would be to assess the frequent violations that are happening in food establishments and provide quality improvement programming for our food establishments. So this is core public health at its finest. So we go in, we inspect the food and lodging establishments to make sure that they're abiding by the requirements and code, but also that they have good hygiene and that folks aren't sick. And all of that's to reduce the risk and dangers to all of us when we're partaking in food establishments for foodborne illnesses. Questions about the grant? This is a no local match.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second that, Bill.
So we have a motion and a second to approve application for this grant. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right. Now some budget amendments. Ms. Rollins.
So a capital project ordinance was not needed for the $1.5 million loan because we intend to spend the loan proceeds immediately. But we do need to amend the budget to allow that to happen. You'll see that there was a list of the projects totaling $1,544,218. Are there any questions?
So this will put the money in the department's budgets once we get the loan.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Next, there's a budget amendment to move $12,236.73 to the school capital reserve fund. This is the amount of sales tax that came in above our projections. So we need to do a budget amendment in order to move those mandatory funds to the right place. The capital reserve fund will then have a balance of, you'll see, $4,157,911. So those funds are available for school debt service and capital projects.
So we made $12,236 more?
More than we projected.
For what?
Sales tax just came in a little bit higher. We tried to project.
What was the time period though?
We were trying to project the May and June sales tax comes in July and August, and we actually amended the budget thinking that they would come in a specific amount so that we'd be able to transfer the funds. We came up $12,000 short of our projection, or our projection was $12,000 short of the actual.
$12,000 more dollars came in
than what you anticipated.
That's correct.
So we couldn't actually do the transfer without adjusting the budget first.
That's right.
I'll second your motion there, Steve.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Carter and Mr. Boswell. We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any more discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, and now we have a library budget amendment.
Good evening, Commissioners. As you know, I've been before you before for the mobile library, the bookmobile. These should be the final actions we need to proceed forward with the project. You had previously approved our RFP. Right now, I just have two budget amendments to get the financing in the proper places to be able to proceed with our vendor. So the first one is for the Library Services and Technology Grant Act grant that we were awarded. The grant is for a total of $100,000 that we just need your permission to accept.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve accepting and moving forward with the LSTA bookmobile grant. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay.
All right, the second budget amendment is organization, our Friends of the Friends of the Alamance County Public Libraries organization is a 501c3 that works with the library to fund various projects and collections within the library. They have been working with us over the years that we've been working on the bookmobile project, and they have now in their possession a total of $79,000 that they are ready to give to the library for the bookmobile project. That money comes from an Impact Alamance grant in the total of $49,000 that they applied for as a 501c3 on our behalf, and an additional $30,000 that they rose fundraised on their own, specifically for this project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, thank you very much. Now we move on in our agenda to the non-agenda related public speakers. And is Samantha Watlington here?
No, she couldn't attend.
Okay, I just wanted to be sure. I saw that her name was crossed off the list, but I wanted to be sure that she didn't come in unexpectedly since she signed up in advance online. Okay, so next is Mr. Charlie Deaton.
Charlie, how you doing? Well,
thank you, sir.
Mr. Deaton, you have 3 minutes to address the board.
I understand. Thank you. Appreciate it. I guess as I was growing up, my dad taught me three things. He taught me how to play golf, which I'm totally grateful for. He taught me not to half-ass do anything. If you're going to get involved in it, get it done and do it right. And the third thing he said, whatever you do, don't sit on the sidelines when you know you can get in the game and you can make a difference. I'm not here to talk to you about golf. So the thing I am here to talk to you about, and I've been here before, is the dilapidated abandoned homes, junk vehicles, and solid waste are becoming a problem in Alamance County, especially in the southern part of the county. And it's kind of interesting, Mr. Baker was talking about this beautiful Cane Creek area, and I can see it right from my farm. I know exactly where he's talking about. Right now on Belmont Mount Hermon Road, we have 3 abandoned homes and 1 abandoned mobile home. On Highway 87, which leads directly into one of these areas, of course, Belmont Mount Hermon Road leads into that area also. It's just disgusting when you take a look at what's happening on Highway 87 South. There are abandoned properties. There are junk cars, boats, and there's even a mobile home that sits there, and within 30 feet on both sides is 2 travel trailers. And they all are lived in. The thing is that I look at is by talking to the tax department, and I've already experienced it myself, these are depleting real estate values in our area. And Commissioners, we do not live in the back roads of the Appalachian Mountains. We're living in a thriving neighborhood. It's growing. As a matter of fact, right across my property is another proposed 37-acre subdivision called Hazelwood. I don't know if it's moved forward. I don't know exactly what's happening. But it's a very simple question I want to ask you. If you had a depleted home next to your property, would you want it there?
Absolutely not.
That's right. Mr. Sutton?
Kind of obvious.
Yes, sir. That is obvious. And the thing is none of the property owners in Alamance County, 75,000 of us, we don't want it either. So I guess, and you know, and I still think that we live in a democratic republic. And if we do, then the majority rules. And if we don't want it, then my question is none of the municipalities around us have it. They don't allow it. And because they consider it to be deemed a danger and a public hazard. And I just have one question, and I want to know, why has this been allowed in Alamance County? Why isn't there a code, a minimum housing code or something in Alamance County to prevent this from happening to us as far as property owners are concerned?
That's a good question.
All right, thank you, Mr. Deaton. If you would return to your seat, now is the opportunity of the commissioners to respond to what you said. I think Mr. Lashley was doing.
Yeah, I think that's a good question to ask. I think we need to do something concerning that, because I see a lot of it.
Sir?
You know, they just abandon their homes, leave them sitting, do nothing about it.
I remember one time we had a mobile home recycling program where...
It
worked very well. We had a waiting list. County was able to use some funding to contract people to come out, pull the home away.
We got rid of a bunch of them like that, too.
And we could look back in to see if those funds are available or if that program is available.
And I think Tanya must have heard us talking about this because she is who I would refer to.
What can we do about
that? Tanya.
Yeah, you're welcome to our meeting.
What do you want me to talk about? The abandoned mobile home thing, the state does allow for grants, which we did get last year removed, but they haven't put that grant back out this year for us to apply yet. So when that grant comes out, we've had multiple people call in our office asking about it, so we'll get it out. We'll put it on the website and put some stuff out so everybody knows about it when we get notice on it.
But our hands are tied as to taking an individual property and enforcing a rule that we don't have.
We don't have a way of taking those down ourselves. Yeah. I guess there's a legal process if we wanted to put some kind of tax lien or something on stuff, but that's involved and that's a whole different way of doing things.
Well, Mr. Lashley, you may recall when I was young and didn't know any better, when I first came here, we had a gentleman in the southern part of town that had his entire piece of property covered with 8 feet of trash.
Yeah.
And went to court. The environmental health folks came out, declared it a health nuisance. We got a court order ordering him to clean it up. I went out there with the sheriff, and he indicated his displeasure with the court order, but we went out and Bud Capps hauled off 226 tons of dump truck loads of trash in this property, including six cars.
Yeah, I remember that.
But it was a struggle. The mobile home recycling ordinance was something that I set up at Jason Martin back when scrap steel was $190 a ton. And we got the permission of the state of North Carolina to take them out to our landfill. We had a mobile home mover that moved them out there, and we had prisoners deconstruct them and put the aluminum in one pile, copper in the other. And we had a machine out there that would cut up the steel. But break even was not achieved even with $196 a ton price of steel. Price steel now, I think, is 4 cents a ton. So, I'm sorry, a pound. So, that's the really driving factor. If you're going to clean up these things, who's going to pay for it? It's very expensive. We do have an abandoned car ordinance, as you know, that requires people to remove cars. We cleaned up a junkyard on Mine Creek Road and had to bear the wrath of the individual. Episode for years. We came to every meeting. That's how mean we were. But the way to do it, I think, is if it's a health hazard, do an environmental health. and have them look at it. If the person can't afford to, then our vehicle ordinance says if you can crank it up, you don't have to move it. If the car will start and move on its own, then we can't do much with it.
Well, when the city bought those as a house in Burlington, yes. What's that mean? They just do their zoning?
What they do is they declare it a nuisance. Either druggies go in or the rats move in or both, and they will bulldoze it down.
Plus, they have a minimum housing ordinance.
They have a minimum housing code.
And
the building inspector goes out and looks at it and condemns it as being unfit for human habitation. And if the person can't repair it, it gets bulldozed. And we have a lot of those problems where we end up trying to sell for taxes over to the county and the city.
So are we dealing with the same thing we were dealing with the mining issue of not having an ordinance that allows us to?
Well, it's the state, really, the state gives the county certain powers to do things. And we don't have a minimum housing code in the county for homes. The cities have those. But we do have a public health and nuisance ordinance that we can use.
I think we need to get one going. There's a bunch of homes like that, like he's talking about. We need to send them a letter, tell them to clean it up, or we're going to do it and send them the bill.
Well, if they're abandoned homes, a lot of times the volunteer fire department will be happy to burn it down.
You're practicing.
So there are alternatives and ways to address it.
Guilford County, remember when they went out on, what's his name's property?
E.S. Hennis, I remember Hennis.
Now, was that zoning allowed that, or can we do that?
Guilford County did that. It was in the county. Ed Pons was the assistant county attorney, a personal friend of mine who brought that action against him.
Yeah.
And they took a bulldozer and they cleaned the lot off.
And billed him for $1,100.
That's the way it ought to be.
$1,200, I remember. Yeah,
that was a big nasty fight.
Yeah, that's a house on Durham Street Extension that I got somebody sent me a picture of. It looks like that. Looks like it caught on fire.
We can certainly take a look at
and
it
anything
and see if environmental health will condemn it, but it doesn't meet the requirements to condemn it, really. And if the cars crank up,
and I'm guessing what you said about there are campers on lots, but I don't know. I mean,
the thing is, if I could briefly mention something, and I mentioned the other day at the planning board, it's obvious that Alamance County does not really like mobile home and mobile home parks. And when I was asking Ms. Cottle about where there are any easements and setbacks to where these will have to be so far from the property line, there are none.
Right.
There are none. And that just blows my mind. You think if it's a permanent foundation, there are easements, but anybody can park a vehicle right on your property line, and it doesn't, as long as they can move it or if it's on wheels, there's nothing we can do about it. And that just kind of, that's strange, considering that the county kind of doesn't want it.
All right, so he's referring to travel trailers, campers.
Right.
They're DMV vehicles. They're not looked at the same way as what we would consider a structure, which would be a house or mobile home or modular home. They all would not, anything that you can move does not meet setbacks. Anything you build and get permits, you do.
Now, in zoning, can we put something in that to alleviate somebody really, no, it is movable, but they've set it up permanently?
Well, building code comes into play on that, and the state has kind of, I would say, waffled over the last few years over that. Currently, they're allowing people to stay for long term in what would be campers, but we still don't have a setback on that. So, you know, if that was something that the county wanted to look at, that can be looked at when we do put some more regulations.
Yeah, I think we should put the setback.
Is that something we might look at in our land development plan?
Probably not to that level. We're kind of doing a big picture on that. Maybe the snow camp thing. Mm-hmm. We could start there.
If we were doing small area plans, mm-hmm. that might be something that could be a topic for a small area to think about.
Right.
Is there any short-term remedy to the problem that Mr. Duke was talking about?
Well, we're working through some of those problems through code enforcement, through our current ordinances. There's a lot has been done. There's still a lot to be done. And those are criminal investigations, so we can't really disclose details on those. But we're working with property owners. As long as they're doing something to improve their situation, we allow them to keep improving that situation. Should we get to where we're not seeing any improvement, that's when we start moving on with our letters and even in going to legal and go back to do what they can.
Tanya, can I ask you a quick question? How long, I mean, this has been going on for a year now. So how long do we allow this to be stretched out?
We don't, our ordinance doesn't have a time frame.
I thought it said if solid waste is 2 weeks. It must be removed every 2 weeks.
Well, that's something that I know Environmental Health is working on. So I don't know the details of what they're doing there. And I know some things have already been hauled off. So, like I said, he's still improving. And he's still under violation. So the violation is still there. It's not been cleared. It's not that we've said you're good. You still get a violation letter and an agreement to try to clean up.
But you do give him a time period.
Yeah, we evaluate every 30 days for ours. Environmental Health does a little bit different than we do, but our ordinance allows us to give something new every 30 days in evaluation.
And if they don't do it, then is there a cost to that person?
There is. If we can't seem to get anybody to respond to us, and we do have some of those, we end up going through a 3-citation process. We still don't get a response. We send it over to legal.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Saint Clyde.
They don't pay the, if they don't pay the cost, do we add it to the tax?
We, in the Lamb case, we managed to recover, I think, about $12,000, and it cost, I think, 14 or 15, this is memory, from 2007 or 2008, but it cost more to clean it up than it did, than the metal was worth, and that's using inmate labor with boots and gloves donated by Home Depot. I mean, we stretched. We went every way we could to try and get that gentleman's property cleaned up. But it was 8 feet high. Sheriff went out there with him. A little path going up to his house. And when Mr. Capp started cleaning up, he found 8 automobiles buried under the tractors. It was unbelievable. I tried to get him removed from the county line, put him in Randolph County, right on the county line. But Alan Pugh wouldn't hear it, but I knew Randolph.
And Bruce couldn't pull that off?
No, we couldn't pull that one off. We were in a battle. We were in a battle with Orange at that time. We started to look at it, though.
Right. Any more discussion about that? If not, Mr. Hago, do you have a report tonight?
I have no report.
Do we have any commissioner's comments tonight? Okay, if not, then I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board, and consult with the county attorney regarding the claims made in the case entitled Alamance County versus Karens, and pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A6 to consider a personnel matter.
Second that.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay. So we need a motion to return to open session.
I move.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to return to open session. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, I have a statement to read after the closed session. The board received a report on the status of the case Alamance County versus Karens and otherwise took no action. So is there any more business before the board? If not, we'll be adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.